Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich on Friday, February the 5th, the year of our Lord, 2016. And now, here he is, live and in person, Mr. Fred Belcastro.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you.
Smiles with you.
And
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing.
When the sun comes
shining through.
When you're crying, you bring on the rain.
Stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling.
Keep on smiling.
Good morning and welcome to the Wealth and Wisdom program. My name is Fred Belcastro, and I'm your host during the next 30 minutes where we'll talk about using our wisdom to grow and protect our wealth. And as usual, we're broadcasting from John DeVita's Broadcast Center on the northwest side of Chicago. And as usual, John DeVita is our director this morning. You're listening to Jack FM 89.7 WRHS out of Norridge, Illinois. For those of you who responded with some questions last week concerning the website, let me give it to you again. I thank you for your great responses that we've had. That website, once again, is fbelcastrocfp.com. And I think that's where a lot of confusion came in. You weren't putting that dot in there. So it's fbelcastrocfp.incomeforlifemodel.com. And I hope you enjoy it. Hope you enjoy the interactive tools that are available to you. I won't go into them now. But if any of you have any questions, give us a call. Our phone number is 630-673-4360. Once again, I've got to say, if you're serious about your financial future, you've got to have the answers to certain questions along with the interactive website. Anyone 50 or older should be hitting this thing almost daily, figuring and seeing where you are, how far you have to go till retirement, answering these questions. You have a rate of return. You're earning money on your 401. For those of you who have listened to me in the past know that I don't consider a 401 a pension plan. What it is that it's a tax sheltered savings plan, and it's not even a savings plan, because when we talk about saving, it's differentiated from investing. Investing, the money doesn't necessarily have to grow, does it? If you've experienced any stock market returns, you know that there's no guarantee that the money is going to be saved. So you're putting it into a tax-sheltered investment plan, and you have hopes that when you reach the age of retirement, whatever that age might be, the dollars will be there. But in the meantime, look at the important things, the rate of return that you need. It's not what the market's going to give you. What do you need? What do you want to have at your time of retirement? And how much more do you need to put aside if your rate of return isn't sufficient or high enough? How much more do you have to set aside? And where do you get the money to set aside? We'll talk about that during the next 30 minutes. And doing what you're currently doing, how long will you have to continue to work? If you're not getting the rate of return, if your need to save is insufficient, how much longer will you have to continue working? And can you work? Does your job or vocation allow you to continue beyond age 62, 65, or as a matter of fact, 70? Are you self-employed, and do you enjoy working? And so you plan to continue for the rest of your life. Listen, I'm past retirement age, and I'm still working, and I tell people I'm going to retire. I'm going to retire maybe 9 or 15 years after I'm dead, because I enjoy what I'm doing, because all I've done is work with a lot of good people. I noticed that sometime, I think I was in the business 25 years, and at that point I said, hey, listen, look at this. 25 years with the CRD number, That's for the securities, the Series 7 and 24 I had. But with this number, not one complaint. And so then it really cautioned me to choose my clients well. And then many of the clients are friends to this day. All right, so if we don't know our rate of return, how much more we have to save, how much longer we'll have to continue working, that's going to result in what? When it comes time for retirement, we're going to have to reduce our standard of living. So if that's the case, how much do you have to reduce your standard of living to last until for your life expectancy? Get the answer. Go on the website, fbelcastrocfp.incomeforlifemodel, and answer these questions for yourself. You know, nobody has to be involved. Nobody knows what you're making, what you have set aside, what your 401 has, what your IRAs have, what your bank account has, what the kids owe you, any of that. Find out for yourself. Take a look and see where you're at. See how those of you who had played football or wrestled or participated in most sports, look at that time clock, right? You want to see how many minutes are left. Well, look, you're 50, 55, how many minutes are left? How much longer will you have to work? And then how much longer do we have to wait for those special occasions? I drove down, I think it was Montrose this morning, and I seen at Ridgewood High School the information was Valentine's Day. They're blinking on and off. Be my Valentine, be my Valentine. And I guess in a couple of weeks it will be the 14th, and that will be Valentine's Day. But I'm not referring to Valentine's Day. I was happy to learn that Punxsutawney Phil did not see his shadow, so it's going to be a little warmer here in the days to come. I heard that it's going to be near 60 degrees by the end of this month, so that certainly is good news. But what I'm talking about when I talk about the time, Valentine or Punxsutawney Phil's time, no, I'm talking about the W-2s you're receiving in the mail. Hey, how does that feel? Does that feel pretty good? How about those 1099s? Have you added them up? Are you doing as well as you thought you'd do? Or are you just saying, oh, holy moly, look at this. What happened to all the money? Well, look at how much we made today or this year, hon. Gee, what did we do with it all? Where did it go? And do you have goals as far as earning an income? The first thing that you want to do is to see where you're at in relation to other people. So are you in the top 25% of earners? Are you top 50% of earners? The information's available. All you have to do is Google. And so I have the numbers for you because I Google them, and these numbers are available from the IRS, your IRS, my IRS. That's the Internal Revenue Service. But let's take a look and see how we rank with the IRS. Would you say your income is common or uncommon? All right, let's take a look at the income game. To be in the top 1%, do you know how much the household income would require? $369,691. How many of us are in that 1% bracket? How many of us are earning over $369,000 a year? All right. Maybe that's a little bit of a stretch. We can't be in the 1%. How about the 5%? Do you know what it is to be in the top 5% in the tax returns according to the IRS? All right, here's the figure. $161,000. It's actually 161,579. All right. How's that feel? Are you in the top 5%? Okay. All right. If you're not, let's go to the 10%. To be in the top 10%, you know what your annual income has to be? Your gross annual income? $116,000. Yeah, there it is. So those of you who are in the top 10%, the earners for the USA and the IRS, according to the IRS tables, feel good that you're in the top 10%. To be in the top 25%, you need just $69,000, close to $70,000 of annual income to be in the top 25%. 50%, to be in the top 50%, 34,000. So even with an income of, say, $25,000 or $30,000, $35,000 or $40,000, you're better off money-wise, at least in earnings, than 50% of the people in the United States. This is the IRS statistics. So you feel pretty good about what you're doing and how you're doing it, except when it comes to, putting that money aside. Well, once you know your income and you feel good about it, and you could make a goal for maybe next year to make a little more, earn a little more, make a plan to achieve this level of income. And some of our younger folks that are striving, coming out of school and ratcheting their way up, they know what they have to do. They know that they have the drive, the fortitude, the education that they're going to work and not stop planning and not stop working until they reach their income goals. I think the secret to the high income is easy. You just learn it, learn what to do, and then, of course, doing it, like jacking up a car. You know, you improve with each notch. Each notch goes up a little bit more and a little bit more, and each time you learn and you practice your new skill, and this is why education is so important. The education, that's not just the book learning, but it's the practical application of skill. You're by doing that, you're just ratcheting up your earning ability, and each step of the way it locks in. As long as you keep increasing your earning availability, you keep ratcheting to higher and higher levels. And then, of course, you want to stay at that thing and not decline. But how about savings? How about saving your money? We talk about that. How about in saving, and then how about investing? Do we talk about that? All these things are good to earn the money. Take a look at the W-2s. Enjoy the 1099s that you receive from the savings accounts, and open up our account statements that we get each and every month. You're feeling pretty good about that. And then I come on the radio, and you turn on the radio and you listen to 89.7 FM, and you hear this guy talking about, listen, there's more to be gained by the elimination of losses. And he's going, what do you mean by that? What I'm trying to do here is pick the right mutual fund. I listen to some individuals, these gurus, and they tell me to invest this way and then that way and diversify. And what does that mean? And how about global and Pacific Rim stocks, large caps, small caps, technological stock? And yet there's more to be gained by eliminating losses. Those of you who have attended my workshops known that towards the end of the one of the last screens I talk about is a bucket with the holes in it, and I say, listen, what would you rather try and do? Fill up a bucket with water that has holes in it merely by putting more water in, or what would you do if you were really smart? If you used some wisdom, some uncommon sense, wouldn't you want to fix those holes, fill up the holes? So I say that. There's more to be gained by eliminating the losses than by trying to pick the winners, trying to pick the stocks or bonds or portfolios or combinations of those things than there is to gain. Let me take a break and have a sip of coffee, and then when we return, we'll pick up the conversation there.
Next time you're found with your chin on the ground, there's a lot to be learned. But he's got high hopes. He's got high hopes. He's got high up high in the sky. So anytime you're feeling low, instead of letting go, just remember that ant. Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
There goes another rubber tree plant.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
anyone could make that ram scram. He kept butt bat bam, 'cause he had high hopes. He had high hopes. He had high apple pie in the sky. So anytime you're feeling bad, instead of feeling sad, just remember that ram. Whoops, there goes a billion kilowatt.
Whoops, there goes a billion.
All right, High Hopes by, did you recognize Connie Francis singing that song? Usually she was at a slower pace, and of course a rendition of High Hopes by Frank Sinatra is of course a classic, but I think Miss Francis put another twist to it and moved it along a little faster, but I hope you enjoyed it. It was High Hopes from, I believe, around 1959. For the last number of years that I've been on the radio, more to be gained by the elimination of losses, plugging up the holes. When we started the program, we said the purpose of this show and of my practice is not to try and throw darts at the board with the listing of stocks, like they have a chimpanzee do every year, but rather than try to pick winners and dazzle you with footwork and strategies and all of this. If we just worry basically about saving some of that 35% of our gross annual income that we spend servicing our debt and just put some of that money away, we'd be far better off than we would listening to the gurus on radio, television, and talk about being able to hit the home runs and have these strategies for retirement. First of all, how much do you need? You know, how fast do you have to go? I mean, if we have to drive from here to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and it's a 2 or 2 hour trip, and we've got 4 hours to do it, do you think it'd be wise for us to go at 85, 90 miles an hour to get there? Wouldn't be taking more risk and putting our life at risk when we've got plenty of time in order to get there? Let's look at the rate of return. How much risk do we have to take in these investments when we have right at our disposal and in our control? And this is another thing too that Nick Murray talks about when we talk about the psychological events that lead us to put money away or warehouse dollars. See, if we reduce our expenses, he goes on to say, we take it upon ourselves to do it. A lot of us like to leave it up to others. And if our investment performance isn't quite up to par, it's not our fault, you see. We don't claim any responsibility. And until you sit down with yourself and take a look at what we've done so far in our investment portfolio, that you really say, gee, maybe I should have taken on a little bit more responsibility and being a little bit more careful. There's not always that axiom of, oh, there's plenty of time. We're in it for the long term. It's a paper loss. They never tell you that it's a paper gain either. You don't have that money in your hand when you, hey, look, you're up 8, 10, 12, 15% in this investment. But that's only paper. You don't have it in your hand. So reducing your expenses is really financial management that's dependent upon you. We don't have to go to the blackboard to take a look at this, but I want you to reason with me on some of these things that I'm telling you, because this is the first step. You know, listen, I've been a Series 7 for the last 30 years. Series 24, I managed brokerage offices. So I understand about investments. I understand the hedging and the strategies that can be done. But right now, with you and I, why would you want to enter strategies, sophisticated or not sophisticated, when we'll make more money by just watching what we do. And I tell people all the time, this is just a little bit aside from what I'm talking about. You don't save money by buying things, okay? So stop telling me that we save 10%, we save 20% by going to this store, by clipping this coupon, by driving across country, or by buying the gas here as compared to there. You don't save money by buying. You're buying something. You're spending money. You're not saving. All right, let me get back to reducing expenses. When we reduce an expense, it has a tremendous impact on the bottom lines. Don't go to the blackboard. Listen to what I'm telling you, because I've got these figures written down. I've already worked them out. We have an annual income of $102,000, and we have a savings each and every year of $6,000. That's pretty good. And if we're going to have a rate of return on our $6,000 of 6%, which I know you're not going to get today, you're not going to, it's no fixed guarantee is going to give you that. But this, for the sake of illustration, for a learning experience, 6% is what we're earning on our $6,000. How much is that? 6 times 6, right? 36. So we have a interest on the savings of $360 a year. Feel pretty good about that? You're earning 6%. You can't get 6% today. But if we're saving $6,000 a year out of our annual income, and we earn 6% on it, that's exactly what it's going to grow to. It's going to grow to $360 a year. Our annual expenses, though, are still $96,000. If you look at an income of $102,000, you saved $6,000, leaving an annual expense deficit of $96,000. If you reduce the expense, the $96,000, by just 1%, what is that in savings? What's 1% of $96,000 is $960. On your $6,000 that you saved, that equates to a savings of 16%. Do you get a return equivalent on $6,000 invested at 16%? Can you go out in the marketplace today and get 16%? Listen to me, I'm telling you. You want 16%? Reduce your expenses by 1%. Instead of the credit cards, the car loans, if we just decrease them by 1%, save an additional $960, not out of your pocket, not out of the kids' education, not out of your transportation, your vacations, and the bowling, any of the sports and hobbies and avocations that you and your family enjoy. By not giving it away, you're increasing your return to 16%. You don't go in the marketplace and get 16%. And this, if you save the 1%, that's guaranteed. That's in your pocket. Nobody can take that away from you. To prove it, let me just say, 16% of $6,000 is what? $960. So just that 1% savings gives you a return of 16% on your $6,000 saving. Is that good? Is that worth plugging up the holes? Or do you want to come to my store, my mutual fund store, and buy more product, buy more water to put in that bucket and not worry about filling up the holes? Take responsibility. Start plugging up these holes. Take a look at the budget. You're going to have to do that. It's uncomfortable. But if you got a flat tire, you got to change the tire. Somebody has to jack up that car. Somebody has to get down, and somebody has to do it. And when we're talking about our expenses, it's us-ins, folks, that have to do it. I did another example, an annual income of $102,000, saving the $6,000. But before I get to that, let me stop this ranting and raving and have another sip of coffee. All right. Oh.
Say it isn't so. Say it isn't so. Everyone is saying You don't love me, say it isn't so. Everywhere I go, everyone I know whispers that you're growing tired of me. Say it isn't so. People say that you found somebody new, and it won't be long before you leave me. Say it isn't true. Say that everything is still okay. That's all I want to know. And what they're saying, say it isn't so. People say passing by that he's younger than I, and it won't be long before you leave me. Tell me it's a lie. Say that everything is still okay. That's all I want to know. And what they're saying, say it isn't so.
What a pretty and soothing rendition of Say It Isn't So by Nat King Cole. You know, it was a song written in 1932 by Irving Berlin. And if that seems like a long time ago, it's still a nice song to dance to. So if we're talking about Valentine's Day dances, isn't that an appropriate song? Isn't that a real class? Again, reducing the expenses. And if I stay with the same $102,000 and we save our $6,000 at 6%, we're still going to get $360. Not to look at what we can get, not to look at the return on our investment, the savings, the 6%, the 4%, we can get 12% in this mutual fund. That's another thing, too. I'd like to know what fund you could average 12% in. It's very, very difficult. And if we did that last year in 2015, are we going to do that in 16 and 17? Unbelievable. Unbelievable how we fall prey to some of this misinformation. Reduce the expense before you start throwing money into some of these things. Take it upon yourself. It's our money. Why risk it? But let's just take that $96,000 the annual expenses, and if it's $16,000, $60,000, $116,000, or $96,000, look at reducing the expense. Because if we reduce the expense by just 5%, do you know what that'll give us in savings? An additional $4,800. Do you know what that equates to on our $6,000? That's an 80% return. The figures are preposterous, aren't they? You're never going to get an 80% return. And this is guaranteed. Reduce your expenses by 5%. That's what it equates to on a savings of $6,000. Play it yourself. It's 80% of $6,000, 6 times 8, 48. That's $4,800. You see, there's more to be gained by eliminating the losses than there is by chasing a rainbow, chasing a dream, having the high hopes, maybe an ant can move a rubber tree plant, but don't base your retirement, the satisfaction, your happiness, your health on a pie-in-the-sky dreams or what somebody might mention to you as you'll earn this, you'll earn that. You want to know what a quantitative analysis showed? According to Dalbar, here's a report. Now, let me just drop this on you. Based on an analysis of actual investor behavior over the 20 years ending in December 31st, 2011, the average equity investor would have earned an annualized return 3.49%. Less than 3.5%. You got 3.5% on your money. Underperforming the S&P by more, that's Standard & Poor, the S&P by more than 4.3%, and outpacing inflation by a mere one-half of 1%, 49 basis points. That's what the actual investor, difference between actual return and average returns. Big, big difference. Know the difference. We've talked about them on the show. Be aware of them. Okay, our time's up. We want to thank you, number one, for listening. Thanks for your response on the website. During the next few days, we'll have moderate weather. Why don't we see if we could do something nice for one another? Be kind to one another and make somebody smile. Talk to you again next week. Thanks for listening and the wonderful replies I'm getting.
When you're smiling,
and the world smiles with you.
And when you're laughing, when the sun comes
shining through.
When you're crying, you bring on the rain.
Stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
When you're smiling,
keep on smiling,
and
the world will smile.
You have been listening to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John Nevita Broadcast Center on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich and the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Friday, February the 5th, the year of our Lord, 2016. This broadcast was directed by John Nevita. Our special thanks to radio station manager Kevin Zeflik of WRHS-FM Norwich and the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment, Mr. John Secondo. Until next time, please be safe and thanks for listening. This broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, February the 3rd, the year 2016. Have a great day, everyone. And this is Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM, Norwich, Illinois. Have a safe and wonderful weekend, everyone.